And today we are with Mr. Anant Tyagi, who is General Manager of Artemis Grill here in Singapore. Good afternoon to you, Anant.
Good afternoon.
Now, Artemis has become very popular very quickly, so the building has only just opened. Yes. Could you tell us, please, about Artemis Grill here in Singapore?
You know, at Artemis, along with the chef, who you'll be speaking to later, we serve simple food that is very well-sourced, where we pay homage to people who have put a lot of effort into growing those ingredients, whether those be vegetables and food that is sourced from all around the world. And it is simply heart on a plate. If you see chef's conceptualization of a dish, it's fantastic, you know, and simple ingredients, and we want people to have a unique dining experience here. And the view, we take full credit for it and complete credit. You know, all that you see, we built it just for you to enjoy the view.
You're open for dinner and lunch at the moment.
We are open for lunch and dinner from Mondays to Fridays, and Saturdays dinner only.
And any plans for breakfast?
Not at all, not at the moment.
Because we
as the chef will tell you later, you know, breakfast is for us to rest and have elsewhere.
This is a very funky building, a very cool building. It's a very green building.
That's
Could
correct.
You tell us very quickly, what is that big flower on the top of the building
Well,
for?
Essentially that, you know, helps towards the green image of this building. It collects water and air. That contributes towards the chilled water flow in the building and also contributes towards keeping the building cooler and saves on utility costs for all of its tenants and helps the environment.
A large part of your business is not only private dining, but also the mice business, meetings, corporate events, this, that, the other. How much of that is the business that comes to Artemis?
If you were to you know, break it down into percentage, it contributes towards 30% of our business on a monthly basis. We are a very versatile venue, you know, from an audio and video capability to us being to completely strip the dining room and make it into a cocktail reception sort of format. I mean, only a couple of days ago we had a fashion industry driven event and it was amazing.
Fernando Arevalo, who is the executive chef here at Artemis Grill in CapitaGreen building in Singapore. Good afternoon to you, Fernando.
Hey, how are you?
Very well, thank you. Now, you're the executive chef here at Artemis Grill. Could you tell us about the cooking that you do here at Artemis?
All right, well, in my cuisine, we wanted to take an inspiration in the Mediterranean region because we wanted clean and fresh flavors. So I look for ingredients a lot in this region of the world. My cuisine is a lot about looking for products. Like I spend a lot of my time, and it's actually my favorite thing of my job right now, is to source products and to look for amazing things. And I've found a couple of great allies that help me through that process. So I look for products, and what we try to do is we try to bring the product to its maximum level. And respecting, of course, the integrity of the product and the flavor of the product, give it a personality, give it a character, which is obviously and in many ways related to my personal life. So we take the product and we make it Artemis, with respecting that, the integrity of it.
The previous chefs that I've spoken to, they've all said that the culture, the heritage of where they come from is very important. How has that affected you, and which different countries have you worked in, and what have you learned from those as well?
Well, everything started where I'm from, with Bogota, Colombia, right? So I think I think everything that you are and everything that you live and your experience, at least with me, is reflected in the food. So I lived in New York, I've lived in Hong Kong, I've lived now in Singapore. I worked in my country as well. And I think everything that you feel and everything that you taste, it comes back to your memory. It becomes like part of your glossary of flavors. And that reflects on the things that you look for when you eat food, when you try food, when you try to build something. So everything every place that I've lived, where the things that I ate when I was brought up, what I ate in New York, even the Asian flavors, the things that I've tried in Thailand and in Cambodia and the places that I've been, it's all part of the experience, and it comes and it's reflected in the feelings. I believe that cooking, it's a lot about the way that you're feeling when you're doing it. So yeah, I think there's I had a couple of friends who came to the restaurant once. Not a lot of Colombians come here, but I had a couple. And they said, you know, I feel some Colombian in it. You know, so there's some spice, there's something that from everywhere that I've been.
You talked about sourcing at the beginning, which is very important, of course. What are some of the ingredients that you found in Hong Kong and Singapore that you have?
Okay, well, it's not much about the specific places, but like, let's say when I was in Hong Kong, I was working with Chef Mario Batali, and he opened up a lot of products for me, and he showed me a lot of charcuterie, salumis, stuff like that. In Singapore, because of opening Artemis, we started with the idea of looking for sustainable food, for sustainable ingredients. And that basically opened up a whole world. And the more that you source, the more of these artists that you find. It turns out that trying to do the good thing is also the tastiest thing, right? And that's something that I found by building the menu in Artemis.
How do you find these people? Because of course sometimes they're very small producers. You need the highest quality, but you need it's very difficult to find them sometimes. How do you source them?
Well, it's a lot of word of mouth. Like, you talk to other chefs who are using it, and I've traveled. I like going to tours, like food tours. Just recently I was in Spain, before I was in France, just looking for products, looking for these people. And I've had the pleasure and the luck to find people, suppliers that understand our needs, and they look for products for us, and of course is good for their business. And they come many times during different parts of the year, during the seasons, and they say, "Chef, you know, we found these vegetables and we want you guys to try it," because they know what type of character my food has. So they bring it to me sometimes. And I think someone asked me this before, and I think the more that you get into this artist and this very specific product, it's kind of like a community. They talk to each other, and they, "Oh, do you know what they're doing in Il Borgo for the balsamic vinegar? Oh, do you know this person who's doing this?" Like, the more that you go into it, the more that you will find.
Well, one thing that a lot of Europeans especially talk about when they come to Asia Pacific, whether it's Singapore, Thailand, or somewhere else, is bread. Do you make your own, or do you buy that?
We do have some of our bread, we do our own, and some of it we sourced also from a very famous bread maker, which is called Frederick Lalus. He pre-bakes the bread in France, and he freezes it, and he brings it here, and we finish the baking process. But he's got the best flour, the best bread, like the best bread in Paris that you can find is from him. So we were able to find him too. He came here to the restaurant, it was so exciting. And you know, we talked about the bread and how to serve it, and basically every aspect of the experience in Artemis has a story behind. The olive oil in the beginning of the meal, the bread, everything is very specifically sourced.
What are some of the highlight dishes, the signature dishes here at Artemis?
All right, well, it changes with season, right? Because you cannot get things all the time. At the moment, the wild sea bass sashimi is one of my favorites. It's a fish that is super special. I found it when I went to Concarneau in France. It's called the boats that fish is called 12-hour boats, means that the boat leaves and comes back before 12 hours, and they come with a tag where you can basically track what part of the ocean the fish was fished from. It's extremely, extremely fresh, and it's basically one of the best fish I've ever had. And we serve it with a Corsican copa, which is also from a very small producer who does not export to any other countries than Singapore. And it's an amazing charcuterie. It's a little bit smoky. And the fish is served raw. And for me, it feels like a little bit like the ocean meeting the earth, something like that.
And a few others, another dish, that's the fish side. What about the meat side of things?
Okay, well, there's one of the biggest sellers is our May Selection tenderloin. So May Selection is a beef that comes from a specific part of Scotland. They have a castle that's called the May Castle, and the cattle is, to be May Selection, it has to be only 50 kilometers around the castle. It's grass-fed, hormone-free, sustainable beef, and it's one of our biggest sellers.
In terms of the clientele that you have here, are most of them local, or are some of them tourists?
I would say that there's a big local crowd. I would say it's around 60%.
How does cooking for the locals here differ from when you're in Singapore or New York, for example?
I think, you know, that's a very good question. What I try to do here personally is I try my food to have character and of course season properly. And they say that locals have a certain palate, but I think when you do things right and then you expose it in the correct way, they will understand what you're trying to do. So we locals like a lot the cuisine that we're doing here, and expats as well. Like, you have to be true to your nature. Like, you cannot think, oh, because we're in Singapore, I have to put less salt, or because we're in Singapore, I cannot do, or because we're cooking for expats, it shouldn't be so spicy. What you need to do is make sure that the food has character and have the guts to follow it. And then make sure that your staff is very well trained so that they can expose the dish for what it is, and then just stick to your guns.
You are Colombian, you're an ambassador of the country. Do you work as well, does Artemis or yourself, do you work with the embassy to highlight and promote Colombian as a tourist travel destination and the food?
I like to say that I represent my country in everything that I do. I don't currently work with the embassy. There has been a couple of articles written when I'm talking about my country and where to eat and what to do and about my country's cuisine. But not at the moment, not working with the embassy. Actually, the ambassador is coming on a couple of weeks. So I'm quite nervous about that.
Do you have any Colombian dishes on the menu at the moment, or is this something that you're possibly thinking about?
I like to think that the more that you evolve as a chef, the less the food, it's about a country, and the more it's about me. So the more that I progress, I get farther away from flags and more about my personal feelings sorted. So I inspire myself in everything that I see. I've inspired myself in tom yum soup. I've inspired myself in arepa de choclo, which is a Colombian dish. I've inspired myself in things that I've tried in France. But the food doesn't, I think when you reach a certain level, you the food belongs to a person, not a flag. So I would say that my food is as Colombian as it is, because I'm the one cooking it.
These days, a lot of the high-end restaurants you go to, and sometimes you leave, it's terrible to say, but sometimes you leave hungry. There's a lot of, how would you describe your food? Would you, and what are your thoughts on molecular gastronomy and these type of things?
All right. I think what I like the customer to feel is that when they see the food, they feel connected to it. So they feel that they know what it is. I don't like food that doesn't look like food, right? So I try to keep things familiar. I want people to find an immediate connection to it and think, oh, this looks great and it's tasty. Not too much, how am I gonna eat this, right? So the first impression should be, wow, well, this looks great, but it feels familiar. There's an immediate connection to the dish. And then when they eat it, they go like, wow, and how did he do that? Right. So at the beginning, when we were talking about the restaurant, I told many times the general manager, I told him, you know, I want people to think maybe I can cook this at home right when I see it, when they see it. And like, it looks beautiful. It's beautifully plated. There's a lot of colors. Maybe like, we could do some of this at home. And then they try it and go like, wow, what is that? I cannot do that at home. Something like that. So we try to elevate our quality and our processes and our like the part of cooking. It's extremely complicated in the back, and then everything else comes out in a simple manner, and food that looks like food. I have nothing against molecular gastronomy, but I don't practice it too much.
How does the lunch here differ from the dinner?
All right, that's very good. Because of where we're located, because we're in the downtown, we have a lot of corporate, and lunch is a very fast-paced environment. So we have the menus are almost completely different. The lunch menu is created in a way that, of course, with the same quality but much more efficiently made in the kitchen, so that people can come in between their work time and have lunch and go back, right? And dinner is a little bit, I wouldn't say complicated, but more elaborated. There's more things going on. And the environment is completely different as well. Dinner is a little bit more romantic. People take more time. They order a bottle of wine. They can have a longer lunch. So a longer dinner. So it's a very different environment. I would say that it feels like two different restaurants.
How open are you to special requests? For example, one of my favorite dishes is beef cheeks or tongue. How open are you to somebody saying, well, I'd like you to cook this for me?
Well, basically, I like people's feedbacks and I take them very seriously, and I keep my head wide open for whatever people are saying around me. I don't cook for myself. The truth is I cook for people and to please them. So I'm happy to hear about what people like, and sometimes it's part of my inspiration. Now, I do try to protect the food as much as I can. I like to think that there's a lot of thought, not only a lot of thought from my end, but there's a lot of work in the things that we do, and from the producers that we the food comes from. If you go back, like I have the luck to do, is you go back to the source, and you see what these amazing artists are doing, and then the process that it's going through. I like to showcase it. So if people suggest me, hey, it would be nice if you cook some tong, I would love that. But then when the food is already made, it has a character. It has a thing that I would prefer that they would try. So because it has a story, and the story is every part of the dish. So I try people to see the food as I created it.
How often does the menu change here at Artemis?
Oh, it's in constant movement. Because working with seasons is challenging, because as the season's ending, it forces you to be creative again and find something else to replace it, because then you'll be left with nothing. But just to tell you an average, I was out of the country, I was in Spain and back in my country a month and a half ago, and it's been a month and a half since I came back, and we've changed around 15 dishes. So, and it's continuously moving. Like, there's new products coming in all the time. There's things happening all the time.
You mentioned earlier in the interview, you mentioned inspiration, and you mentioned the things that you've learned and developed and taken from other places. Which are the three chefs that you look at the most and you watch the most, that you respect the highest, that if you could work with them, who would those three be?
If I could work with them? Oh, wow. That's a hard question. There's so many heroes that I have. The chefs that I have a lot of respect for, chefs that have taught me a lot because I've worked with them. One of them would be Zach Allen, which is the corporate chef of Mario Batali, and my current boss in Mario Batali is Eli Anderson. I learned so much from them in the way of how to make food simple, how to make it so natural and so close to yourself. I learned a lot from them. I feel a lot of admiration for so many chefs. Like, Thomas Keller is such an amazing icon, right? But at the same time, I like David Chan, and you know, there's so many. I had the pleasure to work with Daniel Balut for a while, and just to hear, to see him cook and to hear the way that he talks to people. I think being a chef is so much more than just cooking. It's a lot of inspiring people, because they're not you don't cook every dish in your kitchen, not even close to how many dishes we cook a night. And you just have to put that passion in people's heads and put that passion in people's hearts. And then when they're cooking it, they have to feel what you're feeling, so that the food comes out perfect.
And finally, moving outside of Artemis, your mother, she comes all the way over from Colombia.
Oh, wow.
She comes to visit you now, and she says to you, I'd like to eat Singaporean food. Where will you take her that day, that
Singaporean
night?
Food.
What will you get her to try?
Singaporean food. Well, I like local food, and to be honest, I probably eat more local food when I'm not working, more local food than anything else. I have this really nice seafood place, it was called Minky Seafood, and they have a really great crab with bihun. I would like to take my mom there.
Excellent. Well, on that, Fernando, I have to say thank you very much indeed for your time today.
Thank you so much.
Of course, I wish you, your mother, and of course, Artemis, the best of luck for the future.
Thank you so much.